please the court, Quentin Rhodes on behalf of the appellants LeFer. I'd like to begin with a description of the facts that were known to the LeFers when this case was filed. In June of 2010, their car was stolen. It was stolen in Denver, Colorado. In the car, among other things, was a set of business records from their two businesses. Mr. LeFer ran a business called Western Tradition Partnership, which is a political consulting firm, and Mrs. LeFer ran a business called Direct Mail, which was a printing shop that catered specifically or in particular to...
You have limited time. I mean, if you're going to tell us something, I guess that's not in the briefs, we can listen, but I think I know everything you're going to say if we're just summarizing the facts. What I would like to know is when your clients, when you received the, is it the commissioner, Mr. Murry, summary judgment declarations, right?
Yes, Your Honor.
That, I guess, convinced you that the claim, in fact, had no merit, and that's why you sought to voluntarily dismiss it.
Well, there were two aspects, Judge. There was the aspect of this new evidence that we had never seen before with respect to the timing of the release. The LeFers didn't know when the news media had looked at these documents, and they found out when these affidavits came out that it was in June of 2013, not in September or October. In addition, at that point, the commissioner no longer had possession of the documents. So the lawsuit was filed, and that was the discussion that was had at the outset with Mr. Shire, the commissioner's lawyer.
Well, wait a minute, but the possession of the documents doesn't have anything to do with Claim 3, does it?
Well,
the damage done by it that's alleged in Claim 3 was the showing of the documents to the national media, right?
Well, that's correct, Your Honor, but in the calculus of whether to continue to pursue the case, there are a number of things that were under consideration, and one was, can we get...
Tell me if I'm wrong. I thought the district judge here only sanctioned your clients for continuing to litigate Claim 3. Am I wrong on that?
My understanding, Judge, is that the sanction came from the filing of the complaint in the first place.
Claim 3 in particular.
And Claim 3 in particular.
Right. So I'm saying, that's why I'm trying to clarify, what is it that you learned in the summary judgment declarations that you could not have figured out pretty easily at the very outset? I thought that's what motivated the judge's decision to sanction you for bringing Claim 3. And if what you're telling me is that the thing that was disclosed in the summary judgment briefing was the timing of when the documents were shown to, I guess, is it mainly the PBS folks or whoever else in the media that you were concerned about, it seems to me if had you done a reasonable investigation at the outset as you were obligated to do, you probably could have just inquired of the commissioner's office and they probably would have told you, no?
Well, we made that inquiry. It happened on October 29, 2013, when we emailed a letter stating our understanding of all the facts to the commissioner. That same day, his lawyer telephoned back.
I've read that, and no, you did not inquire as to the timing. You most certainly did not. And I think that's why the judge was upset at the end of the day, because you get all the way through to summary judgment, and then you say, oh, my God, had we only known this, of course we wouldn't have litigated this, Judge. And he says, are you kidding me? This is the new fact that is now, you know, that's the light bulb that's gone off? You could have figured that out, you know, back at the very beginning.
Well, Your Honor, what we said in the letter was that very recently you released these documents to the news media. That's what the statement was.
Right. And that could have, very recently, doesn't, that could have been in June? It could have been in September. I don't know. I looked at those documents. You'd never said, please tell us when and why you disclosed these documents to the national news media. I'm sure they would have said, just as they did in the summary judgment declarations, we did it in June or July, whenever it was, and we did it because we had to, not because we had some nefarious intent to damage your clients. They were public records at that point, or at least that's the position our office was taking.
And, Your Honor, with respect to that issue of whether there were public records, it's our position that it's not a frivolous argument to say that these documents are not public. As a matter of fact, our clients never voluntarily or gave permission for those documents to leave their possession. They never just submitted them to the commissioner voluntarily. The trial judge said that these documents were given over to the commissioner of political practice voluntarily, and so that created the transform them into public documents. But the only person who could voluntarily give those documents to the commissioner would be the person who owned them. And the person who gave those to the commissioner did not own them and did not have any authority or permission from the owners to give those documents away.
Right, and you're right. You have a perfectly valid argument on that point, but that doesn't go to the sanctionable, the frivolousness of the claim, because what you alleged, as I understand it in the claim, is that the commissioner did this for basically partisan political reasons and kind of an intent specifically to damage your clients. And all I'm saying is that had you inquired, the commissioner may well have said, the reason we disclosed them, whether we were right or wrong as a legal matter, was because we thought they were public documents, and here's the basis for our thinking of that. And that's all they ended up saying in the summary judgment declarations.
Well, that's right, Your Honor, but we didn't pursue that, and not because we agree that there's no merit to it. There's a variety of considerations that go into that. There's cost-benefit analysis. There's a risk of winning or losing. There's the fact that the documents were no longer in the commissioner's possession, so continuing to pursue that aspect of the case was moot. So there's a variety of things that go into that. But for the act of releasing those private documents, even if the commissioner decided that, we think that they're public documents, this is our reasoning for it, we differ with that strongly. We think that there's a case to be made to say that, look, if you get these stolen documents and you can see that they're stolen, you can't release them, especially not without at least telling the actual owner that you have the documents, you came into their possession. You may have an issue as to whether...
What is the evidence that he had any reason to think they were stolen at the time he released them? He did eventually, but at the time he released them.
Well, we're not sure about that, Your Honor. We weren't allowed to do discovery, but the news media, the descriptions in the news media were that they were found at a meth house in Denver, Colorado.
Well, I understand that, but how did Murry know that? All he knows is somebody, as I understand it, all the commission and commissioners knew, is that somebody shows up with these documents in Colorado and says, here.
Well, the thing is the commission knew he didn't ask for them from the person who owned them. And so the question then arises, well, these aren't your documents. You're giving them to me. How did you come into possession of those? A, and then B, I've got these documents. I've got no evidence that the actual owner has given permission for them to be released to me. At the very least, the commissioner should contact the owner and say, I've got these documents. I consider them to be public property. They're public documents in my view. But I don't know how they got to me, and you appear to be the owner. What say you? It seems to me that, at the very least, that inquiry could have been made by the commissioner rather than to, A, give access to the documents to the news media, and, B, not even tell our clients that you...
Assuming that inquiry could have been made, lots of stuff could have been made. Was there some sort of legal duty to do it? And unless there was, why would this give rise to some sort of claim? I mean, they could have done it. It would have been the nice thing to do. It would have been permissible for them to do it. But what legal duty do they have? Documents come in their possession. They, on their face, seem to be the kind of documents that the commission receives and files and makes public. But what duty is it to say, we have to question the source and we have to go to the owners to see whether this came to us legitimately?
It seems to us that a couple of reasons. First of all, the nature of the documents themselves. If you look at the affidavits filed by, in particular, Julie Steve, she describes those documents and they include communications with donors, communications with campaigns, they include banking records, the kind of records that, by their nature, appear to be sensitive or private documents. And so the question is, well, we've got these sensitive documents, how did we get them? Well, they were given to us from folks in the Democratic Party in Colorado. Well, how did they get them? We're not sure. Well, at that point, it seems to us that if you've got your government agent, you have duties of good faith to everyone involved in the process. It seems to us, at the very least, you need to give the people who appear to own the documents notice that you've gotten your hands on these documents. And it may be that...
But it seems to you is not a good source of authority. it seems to you that that's what they should have done. I'm asking for why, what legal duty did they have to do that? It comes to them, they seem to be the kind of documents that they handle. Is there something in the law of Montana? Is there something in the federal law or something in the Constitution that imposes a legal duty not to use documents that come into possession of the commission through illegitimate means? Why are they entitled to say, look, these are the kind of documents we get? How they got to us is of no concern of ours. We have no duty to do. You know, maybe it would be a nice thing to do, but so what?
If nothing else, Your Honor, the law of personal property, in that a person doesn't have a right to use property that's not his or hers, and they come into possession of some property that doesn't belong to them, at the very least, they don't. If it had been cash, they couldn't spend it. If it had been other kinds of personality, they couldn't have just put it to their own use.
What does all this have to do with the Constitution? Well, I have two questions. One is, are you at this point, or put another way, at this point, I do not understand you to be contesting the refusal to accept the voluntary dismissal. Is that right?
Your Honor, our contest is simply this. The issue is whether there's a non-frivolous argument that releasing this private information.
So the answer to my question is yes, you are not contesting the dismissal, the refusal to dismiss the voluntary dismissal on the merits.
That's right, Your Honor. We're not contesting the Rule 41 order, and we're not contesting the summary judgment order.
Okay. But I gather insofar as the district judge regarded your request for the voluntary dismissal as an aspect of the frivolousness or vexatiousness, then you're contesting that.
Well, yes, Your Honor, we're contesting the analysis that underlies it, not the result.
Okay. Secondly, all of this discussion about what you may should or shouldn't have known at the outset, how does that all fit, and whether we should have given it back or made inquiry or whatever, what does all that have to do with the First Amendment claim?
Well, our argument, it has to do with the confidentiality under Perry v. Schwarzenegger, that this court recognized that there's a First Amendment right in the confidentiality of political associations. And that falls right squarely in the middle of this case, because the information that was, the key information that's being objected to is the information about the political.
So basically you had a First Amendment right to have Murry ask, figure out where these documents came from.
We have a First Amendment right for those documents not to be made public because they include confidential information about confidential political associations. The confidential nature of those associations is protected by the First Amendment, and that's the crux.
Thirdly, the district court, however, never got to any of it. I mean, in his determination at the summary judgment with regard to why the claim couldn't go forward and presumably why it was frivolous or close to frivolous, it was on immunity grounds.
Yes, Your Honor. The merits of the summary judgment was the immunity grounds. But the
presumably that would be. So, in other words, if we thought that it wasn't so obvious, or at least it wasn't frivolous, whether it was immune, whether in fact Murry was immune, then the basis for the district court's conclusion of frivolity on the First Amendment claim was that, and really not this whole discussion we've been having about whether there is an underlying merits First Amendment claim here.
Well, that's not how my understanding of how he expressed himself on the frivolousness. He, in his ruling on the frivolousness toward the end of the opinion, he said, I rule that there's immunity here, but because these documents are public documents from the outset, I also rule that the claim is frivolous because these documents could not, under any theory, have been regarded as private.
But that, did that go to the First Amendment issue, or did that go to the Public Records Act issue?
Well, we think it goes to the First Amendment issue because his analysis of whether they were public documents is based on state law. And our claim that they're protected is based on federal law, and we argue supremacy there. So we differ with the district court on whether they're private documents or not under state law. But fundamentally, we don't view that as necessarily relevant because we think they're protected under federal law, under the Schwarzenegger case.
You're well over your time. Let's hear from Allison.
Thank you.
May it please the court. My name is Jamie McNaughton. I represent the officer, the Office of the Commissioner of Political Practices and former Commissioner Jim Murry in this case. Also with me at counsel's table, we have Matt Kokenauer, who's an Assistant Attorney General for the state of Montana. And Mr. Rhodes agreed to limit this to the attorney fee issue. And so if the court doesn't have any questions, Mr. Kokenauer intends to allow me to have the 10 minutes to do the arguments. So, like you were pointing out, it's not a question of whether or not Murry gave access. It's the point at which Commissioner Murry gave access to the documents. It wasn't until it's titled their Second Amended Complaint.
Why don't they justify it and say, look, we had these documents stolen. There's every indication that Murry and the Commission had stolen documents. Disclosure of the stolen documents would chill First Amendment rights. And so we're going to bring a lawsuit to try to stop it from disseminating further.
The Commissioner actually agreed to that lawsuit. We found out that they, on October 29th of 2012, that the LeFers claimed that they were stolen from their vehicle. We immediately agreed that afternoon to have a court of law determine whether or not there was an identifiable privacy interest in those documents. The LeFers were also aware that there were competing privacy interests that were being asserted. They were.
You said you agreed to have a court decide.
Correct. The First Judicial District Court.
Do that. Somebody has to file a court.
Correct. And we agreed that Mr. Rhodes would file that with the court, and we agreed to having a protective order issued until such time that they are able to make that determination.
Okay, so what's he being sanctioned for?
I'm sorry, what's
he being sanctioned for?
He's being sanctioned for continuing to pursue the claim against Commissioner Murry in his individual capacity for violating their First Amendment rights.
Just to be clear, he wasn't actually sanctioned. Instead, there was an award of fees to the defendant under 1983.
Correct.
And the standard is different. In other words, if the judge had wanted to issue a sanction, that would have been a different story, but that's not what happened here.
Correct. We were awarded attorney's fees that it took to defend against the Section 1983 claim. And those are reviewed for an abuse of discretion.
Some of what the judge said in support was very much sanctions language.
Like tone.
Correct.
None of that is relevant to 1988. Yeah, right.
No, you look at the facts that the LeFers knew or should have known at the time that they filed their complaint.
Yeah, I say potato and you say potato. My question.
I apologize, Your Honor.
You didn't hear my question.
Apparently I didn't.
You didn't answer my question.
I would like to.
Well, go ahead.
I'm sorry, would you mind repeating it?
None of that was relevant to a 1988 determination. The tone, the litigation tactics, the fact they were all over the place, because you know, all the stuff that he said has to do with the way they conducted the litigation is irrelevant under 1988. True or false?
False. If they continue to litigate once they knew facts.
No, that's not what I asked. That's not what I asked.
Okay.
I asked the all the stuff the district judge said. He said other things too. But all the stuff that he said about how they the method that they used to conduct the litigation. That's not properly taken into account. I mean, if he thought that they were engaging in delay or using abusive other provisions that deal with that. We have Rule 11. We have all sorts of powers. This court has all sorts of powers to deal with abuse of litigation tactics. But none of that has anything to do with 1988, whether you get, whether a defendant under 1983 can get fees from a civil rights plaintiff under 1988. Isn't that right?
Your Honor, I still disagree. We're talking about a series of five complaints that we're talking about a series of five different complaints that were filed that continued to not do a reasonable examination of the record of who was the commissioner when the records were actually received. Who did the review? I mean, we had three different.
Also, so your position is that abuse of litigation tactics are probably taken into account in 1988. It's not the frivolousness of the complaint alone that matters, but that if you litigate in an abusive way, you think that can be taken into account in awarding 1988 fees.
I believe it's.
That's your position.
Your Honor, I believe it's frivolous if you continue to make the arguments and amend your complaint, and not review the facts. It wasn't until the second amended complaint or the fifth in a series that they actually.
What facts did they not review? I mean, for example, Judge Malloy said that they asserted ownership of the Colorado documents without even asking to look at them. But that's not really a dispute, is it? I mean, these documents, or at least some of them, showed up on the news, and I presume they recognized them and knew they were there. So why did they have to look at them separately?
Because there was only a small portion, actually, that showed up on the news.
Right, but they knew the history of this, no one's debunked this yet. I mean, if it was stolen, there's a big chunk of things all stolen together. And some of them show up in the news, the inference that all of them were together and that they were all the ones that were in the possession, Murray's possession, is not so frivolous, is it?
But that assumes that they belong, that it was identifiable that they belonged to one party. We're talking about 25 different candidates or so. We're talking about seven.
Right, but they know what they had. They knew what they had that was stolen.
We knew that they were provided to our office.
They knew.
LeFers knew?
What was in the boxes? What it referred to, that it referred to 25 candidates, they knew what they had.
They never exactly clearly said that on the record. They said that the media has reported that this is what is in the boxes.
Uh-huh.
But they didn't.
And we knew what was in the boxes, our boxes, so they're asserting it was theirs. I mean, that's not crazy.
It's not crazy, but there were other organizations that very same day that were also asserting.
Well, that makes sense, too, because they were representing other organizations, so they may have had material that belonged to other organizations, but it was also theirs in a sense. It was in their boxes.
You're talking about something that they...
I mean, that just seemed like a funny thing to attack them on, that they had to look at the documents when they knew what they had that would have been stolen.
Okay.
So why did they have to look at them? And a few other of the things that are running around your brief, though, you know, as showing their vexatiousness and their frivolousness. I mean, things like this ex parte hearing in state court. I mean, you know, it's not that clear a line between we're going to do this morning or we're going to do it at 8:00. So what did they do that was so terrible there?
It was actually filed the next day. That's on the record as well. So they contacted us at 5:30, former counsel, Mr. Shire, 5:30 that morning, and said, we intend to present this to the court this morning at a courthouse that's about 2 hours away.
Okay.
From Helena.
Right.
To the...
It's either 5:30 and you file it at 9:00, and... it's a quibble. I mean, it just seems to me to be a quibble in terms of demonstrating vexatiousness.
Okay. What the LeFers failed to do is to even look at who the commissioners were when the documents were received. It wasn't Commissioner Murry. It was Commissioner Hensley. They were reviewed. There were three different commissioners, Commissioner Hensley, Commissioner Kallick, and Commissioner Murry, who were responsible for maintaining and allowing public access. if we allow public access, we have to walk through a constitutional analysis as to whether or not there is an identifiable privacy interest in those documents, and whether or not society will look at those documents and determine that that privacy interest, whatever it may be, is reasonable.
Do you, say one other thing, do you think the absolute immunity issue was cut and dried and therefore frivolous to have named him at all?
Yes, because...
Was there any case law saying that?
Yes, Dodie.
There's a case law about this commissioner, these commissioners?
This commissioner? No.
No. Okay, and there is also case law that treats differently the administrative functions and the adjudicative functions of people like prosecutors and so on.
Yes, but this involves discretion. When you decide whether or not you're going to provide public access to records.
It involves discretion, but it's not tantamount to adjudication.
It's appealable to the district court, and the Montana Supreme Court has dealt with this extensively when it comes to state agencies. And how we chose not
but
to...
All I'm saying is, it seems far from frivolous. There's no case law. This guy has many hats that he plays. It seems to me difficult to say it's frivolous.
Respectfully, I believe it was frivolous when it was brought against the commission.
On that point, I'm asking. So if it was, and the district court seems to have had some sense of this because, as was pointed out, when he went to the fees issue, he didn't rely on the absolute immunity. He relied on the merits of the First Amendment claim.
But he also relied on the facts that they knew or should have known at the time that they brought the lawsuit against the state.
That what?
That we had a responsibility to provide public access to records. We have not only the generals in Chapter 2, but we have specific statutory requirements, as well as a constitutional analysis that the commissioner has to step through when providing access.
I think what irritated the judge here, in my view, was that the basis for Claim 3 was this allegation that the intent of the commissioner in disclosing these documents to the media was to harm the plaintiff's interest, to chill their First Amendment associational rights. And what the judge said was that was completely groundless. You had no basis for making that allegation. And if you had bothered to do even a minimum of investigation, you would have found that the intent was totally different. That's how I read the judge's order.
I agree.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.